I think now we have come to the deliberative part, the conclusion of the deliberative part, and now I have an unenviable task of what you usually call summing up, but I don't want to call this summing up. I will just say it is scratching the surface, because if I choke in the process of doing that, not my fault, because you have given such complex and such deep going thoughts and comment, to do that in so deep a substance in so short a time, without doing violence to any of the speakers, is indeed indeed a very difficult task. But let me try to give you some general points. It seems we of course had a very thoroughgoing, detailed discussion, deliberation, and I hope I will not be overstating the case if I were to say that they were incisive comment and very deep going observations, in addition to a wealth of knowledge. Now, some general points are that there is no dispute. Everybody seems to feel that the center of power, as I think it was Admiral McQuinnin who put it, the center of economic gravity has shifted to the Indo-Pacific region. Others pointed out that rising powers should make judicious use of it, and existing powers, I don't want to call them declining powers, existing powers recognize this, should recognize this reality, as Colonel was just now saying. And also, on the hopeful side, there is no inevitability of conflict. This so-called legendary propensity to conflict between the rising power and existing power, this Greek story, is not an inevitable thing. And the people must work collectively, work constructively, enhance cooperation, and convert asymmetries into complementarities, maximize common ground, minimize provocations. As Colonel Jin Song of China said, maybe the opportunities are larger than challenges. So perhaps we must seize them, and building strategic trust through a new security concept. And maybe China also has a challenge. China's diplomatic challenge is to show that it is an opportunity and not a threat. And this is not only by posture, but by capabilities. So especially in times of instability in their relations, building strategic trust is important. Nevertheless, it is also the reality, especially in our region, that nations and even people read intention not by postures, but by capabilities. So it's a very important thing for us to remember. So the Indo-Pacific region straddles a very large economic space, and the land sea routes there, and those sea routes were, sea lines of communications were described as economic lifeline of the world, as well as it contains some strategic, critical strategic maritime passages. So peace, stability, and security of all these routes and links require a norm-based and a rule-based order, preserving which is of interest to everybody, developed countries, developing countries, emerging powers, existing powers, and also budding powers, intending powers. So for these and host of other challenges, for common security and prosperity, including environment, sustainability of world growth and prosperity, collective work, multilateral work, constructive cooperation common but differentiated responsibility are guiding leads, as was pointed out by many speakers, especially Major General Rahman of Bangladesh, who touched on new wave of terrorism on the one hand, and here I'm very careful quoting, and the right-wing populism, I think my friend Professor Shanthe Nayaka very correctly pointed out, we must be careful in using the term, but it is a perception, right-wing populism on the other hand. And Brigadier General Wahid of Maldives, who very correctly pointed out to the modern-day threat spectrum evolving into assuming many new disturbing dimensions, where he referred to ideological dilemmas, he referred to extremist elements, etc. Incidentally, I must congratulate the Maldives. I was in New York when they took leadership to bring the climate and environmental issue as an agenda item to the UN Security Council. So these are new, what he called the evolving security spectrum. As regards other thematic issues of trends in nuclear politics, valuable insights were offered by Professor Hasan Khan about uncertainties concerning what he called, what he described as salience and role of nuclear weapons in the current context especially, and what might be called selective proliferation or nuclear exceptionalism, like what we witness in Korea, Iran, etc., and in fact in South Asia, in India, Pakistan, these are the perceptions. So these are potential areas in which existing conflicts can be nuclearized and a nuclear dimension added to it. Not added, I mean, hopefully it can be prevented. And also Dr. Mailwaganam, who correctly pointed out how the escalating nuclear brinkmanship in North Korea would impact not only the Korean Peninsula, but beyond that, the United States, China, and their interlocking relationships, and even beyond, even involving other countries. However, there was general feeling, though, the necessity of cooperation and a non-provocative approach to this. Non-provocative approach to this festering issue. It's a festering issue. Everybody agrees on it, but people don't agree on solutions. Of the nuclear dangers emanating from the Korean Peninsula. Another hopeful thing was, I just saw on CNN, Secretary of State of the United States recently said that they are not seeking regime change, etc., willing to talk and all that, hopefully. Then other regional hotspots, value of regional facilitation and mediation to build confidence and seek democratic solutions all around, especially non-traditional threats to peace and security emanating from non-state actors, was highlighted in a very educative and analytical expose by Major General Dato Abdul Rahim. I don't want to risk further pronouncements, but there was also good, very proactive question answers, probing and commenting on issues and many other aspects, which I am sure I must have missed many of these. All these hopefully would be in our rapporteur's report and the conference report. So it remains for me to thank everybody, especially our distinguished and learned speakers in the morning and the early afternoon session, and now for their valuable and very thoughtful contributions and your participation. Finally, to the KDU for this excellent titling of this conference and very good substantive and programmatic preparations. Vice Chancellor, everybody, Brigadier Rajapaksha and his team, and many of the young lecturers and others who contributed to this. I want to thank them and wish them a further successful technical collaboration. So I hope I have not overstepped time, and you will have some time to relax now, because morning session was very much over time, and I believe there are some presentations. We will stay here for a few more minutes.